Miss Virginia Apelian is an accomplished individual. We are honored to have her speak and present this evening at Kean University. Miss Apelian is a psychologist, lecturer, assertiveness trainer, and author. She has received many local, state, national, and international accolades. In addition, her work has been recognized in various professional publications. One of her publications, Musa Dagh Girl, Daughter of Armenian Genocide Survivors, is written about in your program and available in the side room of the theater at the conclusion of the program for purchase and for book signing. I have had the pleasure of speaking with Ms. Apelian multiple times, and tonight I have the distinct honor of providing her introduction. To list her accomplishments individually would be very, very time consuming. So I have selected a few to provide you with the positive, compassionate, caring, and loving spirit of Miss Apelian. Even though her public service began prior to 1988, she was awarded the gold pin for 25 years of active service for humanity by the Armenian Relief Society. In 1982 and in 1987, she was recognized at Kean University by the Professional Women's Organization. In 1984, she was honored by the New Jersey General Assembly for her professional accomplishments, civic leadership, and service to community. In 1990, she organized Christian mission work for the Armenian Missionary Association of America. Here she worked to organize funds for Armenian earthquake victims. She was selected by the International Biographical Center of Cambridge, England as the International Woman of the Year for 1992 to 1993. Shortly to be followed by another honor of Woman of the Year by the Armenian Biographical Institute. In 1996, she attended the International Conference on Arts and Communications in San Francisco and received a Certificate of Honor. Her lecture, given at the conference, strongly resonated with me, and I think with the Kean University community, so please allow me to quote. We must eradicate prejudice to make a better society for all, especially for our new generations. Each one of us can make a difference in order to propagate harmony and goodwill toward all human beings. We must have the vision to see beyond the obvious in order to make a difference towards the betterment of our society. Not just by standing by while wrong is done, but to keep a constant vigil against discrimination. We must teach that to our children at a very early age. I selected this quotation because here at Kean University, we encourage much the same. Please join me in welcoming Miss Virginia Apelian.
Most kind introduction ever. I really enjoyed working with you.
Thank you.
So she's a wonderful person. She always got back to me, and I am so happy and humbled to be here tonight because she invited me. So I just want to say a few words before.
Armenian history is quite long. I'll be giving you a summary of it. It's going to be a very interesting trip. So sit back. We're going to travel about 4,000 years. Of course, I'm not going to get every detail because if I do, then we will be here 2030. So I don't intend to do that. First of all, I'd like to greet all of you that we're all children of God. Those of you who believe that, fine. Those of you who do not believe that, that's fine with me too. I'm not imposing my fate on you. But we're all created in the image of God. Whether our skin is black, white, red, it doesn't matter. We're all children of God and we're sisters and brothers. With that intent, we can always be respectful and lovable, whomever we meet or our neighbors or anybody that is in contact with us. Nobody is bigger and more powerful than another person. With that intent, I'd just like to greet all of you very sincerely. I don't know if there are some even Muslims here, atheists, Christians, Jews, it doesn't matter. We're all brothers and sisters. Now, as I said, we're going to travel about 4,000 years. Armenians were considered by David Marshall Lang, who is a historian, and he wrote many books, historical books, but he wrote a book that he said Armenia was the cradle of civilization. What does that mean? That we were a civilized nation way back 4,000 years ago. And then I read some other items about in the recent past that they found a shoe in one of the provinces in Armenia. It was a male shoe, and they examined it, and the scientists found out that this shoe was about 7,000 years old. Now, I don't know beyond that how that happened, but I can tell you a story tonight that starts from 4,000 years and on. Armenia was governed by dynasty. We had 26 kings. And our Dikran the Great, in the first century of BC, he was very remarkable. He was so influential and he loved the people. And the Armenians at that point were very rich and commerce was good. And imagine if you can visualize the map. From Caspian Sea to the Black Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, all that area was all Armenia. However, there were many wars by the Mamluks, the many other neighboring countries that it got smaller and smaller. Our last kingdom was Kingdom of Cilicia, which was right next to the Mediterranean Sea. And our last king was Leo V. And again, the Egyptian Seljuks attacked and he was in exile in Paris and he passed away. So that is the last of the Armenian kingdom, the 14th century. And from the 15th century up to 20th century, we became subjugated to the Turkish Ottoman Empire. Before I get to go to the intricacies of the genocide, let's see some more information before that. How did Armenians become what they were? As you know, after Christ died and got risen, his disciples went to different countries. And the two disciples that came to Armenia were Thaddeus and Bartholomew. And they tried to evangelize Armenia, and there were many pockets of Christians there, But the king, Dertar, at the time, was not an Armenian, was not a Christian, I should say, and he forbade anybody to talk about that. And St. Gregory came around 3rd century, and he started preaching, and the king did not like that. He put him in a very deep, deep ditch. That was like a prison thing. We call that in Armenian, Khor Virab. So he stayed there 13 years, and two women used to come give him a little water and food to make him, you know, alive. And finally, King Dertad got ill, and he had a vision, and he became a Christian. And he released St. Gregory from the Khor Virab, from the deep ditch that he was at. By the way, my husband and I visited Armenia in 1986, and now on top of that hill, there's a church and a monastery, and the Khor Virab is right there, and I tried to go down. I went halfway down. It was so dangerous. I said, I'm coming back, because the stairs were made of wood, and then it started squeaking and cracking, and I came back. But many people from all over the world come there, because that was the first Christian nation, and King Dertad made Armenia officially 301 AD the Christian nation in the world. And thus, Saint Echmiadzin was built in Yerevan. That's a beautiful, beautiful church. And many people from all over the world come and see Saint Echmiadzin. That was 301 AD. Now, even they became Christian, they didn't have their alphabet, they didn't have their own Bibles. They had spoken Indo-European languages, mixed some with Greek and others. And Saint Mesrob was a very leading, very astute priest. He took his disciples, he said, I will go and find out how we can get a whole lecture for the letters in whatever way our speech is. Now, Armenian is a very beautiful language. As a matter of fact, it's said that if anybody has to speak an international language, it should be Armenian. And I'm not just saying that because I'm Armenian, but grammar is so steady. The sound system, you don't combine letters with any other letters to make a sound. For instance, in English, you say sh, sh. And if you want to say I'm chatty, so ch. But in Armenian, you have a letter for every sound, plus a hard one and a soft one. So if you can learn Armenian with your ears, it's very, very easy to speak it, because the grammar and everything is very, very consistent. It doesn't change. Let me give you a small example. For instance, if you want to say the Tsar of Russia, Tsar, that's a sound which is softer. And then if I say the Tsara, that means a tree. You see, your ears have to be so accustomed to that. Now, if somebody's learning English for the first time and you try to learn the grammar, let's say book, you add an S to it, it becomes plural, it becomes books. Make the plural of foot. It's not foot, it's feet. And then you have B-O-U-G-H, that's a bough, a branch. And then T-O-U-G-H, what does that become? Tau? No. What does it become? Tough. So you have to have a memory for the English language to learn it. And if you like to see the Armenian alphabet, I wrote it out in both print way and the script way. It's going to be in the exhibit room after my talk tonight. So you're welcome to come and peruse and see a lot of historical events. So after many years looking how they can make this perfect, St. Mesrob Mashtots is where he came from, they created the Armenian alphabet, 36 letters. And later on, during the kingdom of our last kingdom, they had added two more letters. So as a whole, It's 38 letters. Okay, so we know about the Armenian alphabet, we know about the Christianity. Now, in 451 AD, Persia, today's Iran, which has been in the newspapers, in the news lately, they wanted the Armenians to become Zoroastrianists. They were worshipping Zoroastrianism, and they forced Armenians to do the same. And of course, Vartan Mamigonian, who was our leader, he was such a devout Christian. He got his army of 66,000 on the battlefield of Avavrair and came to meet the Persian army, which was 300,000 plus 10,000 horsemen plus elephants. Now you say elephants, those were the tanks of today. They ran right into the people, you know, damaging. And that was 451 in the summer. The Armenians started with prayer and having communion, and the priest prayed with them, and Saint Vartan said, "You can take anything from us. You can scare us with fire, sword, anything. We will not give our religion at all." The reason I'm emphasizing this part, that is the reason that later on the same thing happened when the Armenians became subjugated to the Turkish Ottoman Empire. They never wanted to give their religion away. They were Christians. And of course, that was a sore point with the Turkish government. There were also Jewish immigrants there, and minorities, and Greeks. And those were not as big as ours, because we had lived in that whole area. So that whole area was Armenian minorities. After they got their alphabet, our Bibles were translated, and it is so easy for people to read the whole stories rather than from mouth to mouth. It never stays the same. So that was perfected. Now, they again had many wars, Armenia. They lost more ground. And that part is quite lengthy. You have to really study it in detail. But I'm not going to dwell on that too much, except that it came the time when 1894 and 1896. By the way, the Turkish Ottoman Empire was governed by sultans. The House of Osman had 35 sultans. The first 10 sultans contributed a great deal to make the empire really wide and rich. The next 25 sultans got everything downgraded. They lost ground, they lost many things. And the very last sultan, Sultan Abdul Hamid II, was a brutal, brutal ruler. Europeans called him the Red Sultan because he had so much Armenian blood in his hands. Now, if I describe some of them, it's going to be very gory, but I'll just touch upon a few, because he was that. He would take his imams, go across towns and collect all the little boys, tie their hands and feet, turn them on their tummy on the ground, while one imam is reading the Quran, the other one was going around cutting the heads of those little boys. When the parents could not take that, they would be sobbing, screaming. They ran into the nearest church, locked the church. Guess what? They went and poured kerosene all around the church and burned them all alive. He did such brutal things. And then he released all his prisoners free. And these were all criminals. They went ransacking Armenian businesses, homes, raping the young women, and such horrendous things. It was unbelievable. And finally, the European country said, if you continue this, we're going to send all our journalists, and you're going to be, you know, you're going to be seen everywhere, so everybody's going to hate you, and you're going to get out. And at that time, the young Winston Churchill, he did not know what to call this crime. He said, this is so horrific. There's no name for this. Anyway, he killed about 300 to 400,000 Armenians. Then there was something brewing in his own empire. First of all, he was a very, very phobic person. He built extra walls around the palace because he was always afraid somebody's going to kill him. He even called his own ministers, his own Turkish ministers, parasites. He didn't trust anyone. So he wanted to make a name for himself to kill all the Armenians once and for all. However, there was something brewing in his government. There were young Turks that they didn't want him to be that ferocious, to get a bad name for them. They wanted to build a new government. They called it CUP, C-U-P, Committee of Union and Progress. In 1908, they came out. They wanted to cast out Sultan Hamid, which happened. He was let go. And this group came on the surface, and the Armenians were so happy. They thought, this is great. They're going to westernize the whole empire. We may have a chance now. What they did, they sent thousands and thousands of Armenian young men, 20 to 40 years old, to the army because they wanted to be contributing to this new government. By the way, here I can mention to you that in all of the history, Armenians were such good citizens. At that point, the bankers, the professors, the lawyers, the commerce people were Armenian. If they didn't help, that Ottoman Empire would have gone down much sooner. They knew that, but they just wanted to get rid of them because they will not become Muslims. Now, in the Armenian communities, in the Armenian generations, Armenian hearts, there are three very basic things that we really cherish. Number one, it's our church, our religion. We're Christians, and we're proud of that. And we instill that in our children, and that's how it was from 301 AD on to now. The second thing, family. Family is very close-knit, and in Armenian communities, you never saw nursing homes. The mother and the father of the family became the main person who sat at the head of the table, and they were revered, very much respected. Henry and I, when we went to Armenia, he had a lot of cousins there because they, when Stalin was in rule, he sent his officers to get migrations from Armenian communities, and some had gone there to build Armenia as it is now. And when we went to their house, it was so beautiful. The table was from here to there, all the cousins and children and grandchildren, and but the grandfather sat at the very head and the grandmother sat at the very head, and they were so revered. And that was a beautiful picture. And another thing that was interesting, we here in the United States, we're used to eating 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock, and they don't in Armenia, they didn't. I don't know if they changed now. And in Europe too, in Spain too, nobody opens their restaurants at 6 o'clock. It starts 9 o'clock. From 9 o'clock on to 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, they're still eating and dancing and singing and all that. It was a big treat for us. So we enjoyed that tremendously. Now, let's go to April 24. What happened was, in the summer of 1914, World War I broke. The Archduke of Austria and his wife were murdered. So that gave a lot of commotion. The war began September of 1914. And that gave those young Turks the idea, this is a great opportunity for us. Now that the world will be busy with the war, this is the time to get rid of the Armenians, but they had a different method. They said they're going to deport them from their homes. Now, just imagine you're sitting having dinner with your family, having your child's birthday, you're singing happy birthday, and all of a sudden you get a knock on your door. Some policemen or gendarmes, whatever they were, they call you, they say, well, be ready, tomorrow you're going to be deported. Huh? Deported where? Don't ask questions. And those towns that asked questions, and those towns that resisted, they were killed immediately. They were shot, they were beheaded, and many other atrocities. Now, this was getting around the news all over the towns. We had a young minister in Zeytun, which was from Musa Dagh. Now, let me explain what Musa Dagh means. Musa in Turkish means Moses. Dagh means mountain. Mount Moses Girl. That's what I call my book. Now, you may say, why did you call your book Mount Moses Girl? Because I was born there years later. The very same town my mom and dad were born. And they got their decree that they're going to be deported beginning of July. Now, this minister was in Zeytun. They annihilated. They just killed all the people there. And he wanted to come to his own town to tell his people what is happening. He says, don't believe that they're just deporting you to take you someplace else. They're killing you because that's the purpose, to deport you, because during the deportations, they took them to the Syrian desert. By the way, I went back to see where Syrian desert was. Before I wrote my book, I wanted to go to see the Syrian desert where my people died with hunger, starvation. And I wanted to go to the top of Musa Dagh. I'll come to that, and I have pictures that you can see. So they had given the decree to the seven villages of Musa Dagh. Now, we say seven, but other people say six, because one of the villages was only two families. And we skip that, we say six villages. There were Bakuf, Khederbek, Bityas, Haji Habli, Kebise, Yonoluk. Those are very big villages. And they were right under the Musa Dagh, Mount Moses. They were all, the higher one was Bityas, then it was Haji Habli, the middle was Yonoluk, and by the seashore was Kebise. When this minister came, his name was Dikran Antriasyan. By the way, they gave him a lot of trouble, the Turks, because they wouldn't allow him to get out of Zeytun. But the Christian missionaries from the United States, Presbyterian missionaries, they made him possible to get out of there with his pregnant wife. And they got to Yonoluk. When he got to Yonoluk, he called all the mayors, all the leaders, all the ministers, and all the priests, saying that what the intent of these young Turks are, not just to deport you, but they are killing everybody. And those three major ones who were the culprit of the whole thing was Talat Pasha, Enver Pasha, Jemal Pasha. Pasha in Turkish means lord. These were military men, and they just took upon themselves to get rid of the Armenians. Okay, now, our group had their decree to get out and be ready. When they came, they're going to be marching to the desert. They had long discussions till dawn that we're going to get killed anyway. Why should we stay here, wait for them to do that? And they're going to abuse our women and kill us in a very horrific way. Why don't we die honorably? We go on top of Musa Dagh and fight. Now, of course, we didn't have a big army as they did, but we had about 200, 250 young men who were very good sharpshooters, including my mother's two brothers. They were very, very good marksmen, and they fought in that Musa Dagh battle. And the younger son of Father Abraham. By the way, we name a lot of biblical names. We have a lot of Moses and a lot of Abrahams and Solomon and all that. We use those names. And Father Abraham gathered all the major leaders with Minister Reverend Andrea. He decided that the best thing to do is to get to the top of the mountain, fight the Turks. If they kill us, we'll die honorably. If not, maybe, maybe there will be a warship passing by the seashore and they save us. Now, they weren't sure of that, but they prayed and they said, we'll do that. The majority of them decided they're going to do that. In Haji Habli, the minister there said, oh, we may be punished more severely if we disobey the Turkish government. Therefore, let's not go. So there were some families who stayed. By the way, nobody heard of them anymore. They were gone. They were killed. But before they were killed, about 100 gendarmes come the day that they're going to take them on their deportation trips. Almost all the houses were empty. They said, where are they? Where are they? They went and forced the people who had remained there. They said, they're all on top of the mountain. And the way they did that, when it turned dark, they took their pots and pans, their mattresses, their pillows, whatever they can take, their grain, their lentils, their whatever, so that they didn't know how long they're going to be there, and their cattle. They were all organized there according to the villages. And Father Abraham's son, Moses, that's another Moses, Moses de Calustian, he was a very intelligent young man. He became almost the general of the group. He didn't have any military experience, but he knew exactly what group should be where and which the trees should protect them. And then the roads, he gave orders to the men who were not in fighting condition to cut branches to cover all the roads so that Turkish soldiers cannot come up easily. And even the little boys, anywhere 7 to 10 years old, they were the messengers. They didn't have like today's iPhones, smartphones, whatever, to communicate. So if a group was at this point, they would write down, the Turks are coming, they're about this area. They would bring that note to the other group, and this way they carry their information. And the elderly women were the cooks. They cooked, and the young ladies, my mom was an engaged young lady, and my grandparents on my father's side, they were so afraid they're gonna kill their only son, they sent him to America. So my father came to America, and my mother was very, very sad, and she thought maybe she'll never see him again because they never knew how quickly the Turkish soldiers were going to come and kill them. In August, the fighting became fierce. Not only the fighting, they had rain, so much rain. All their blankets, everything was all drenched. People were sleeping on rocks. And also their ammunition, which they didn't have that much ammunition, that was kind of spoiled. They were getting very, very anxious. Now, they stayed on that mountain 53 days. By the way, Franz Werfel, the Jewish novelist, wrote that big novel about the Armenians on Musa Dagh. And this was purchased by MGM, 1933, to be made a movie. This is a long story, but if you're very much interested in how they detained that picture being made, they bribed everybody they could, and they threatened our State Department, if this picture is made, we'll do such and such, just like they do now. I'll come to that later. And that picture was not made. And Clark Gable was supposed to be the leading man. Can you imagine what kind of a picture that would have been gone all over the world? By the way, Franz Werfel's novel, this German, I think his background was German Jew. He was so, so interested to write this story because he was visiting in Damascus. He saw some orphans working very hard and he wanted to know where are they from. And when they described them that they are from Armenian Genocide, they were the little orphans left over. And he came and wrote that story. By the way, after my talk, you can come to the exhibit room And I have my website. And if you're interested to see the 40 Days of Musa Dagh, a rich Armenian millionaire, he said, I'm going to make it. Of course, it's not on the level of MGM's picture would have been, but he made the picture. You can sit down on your at your home and watch the whole thing. It's about 2 hours, but it gives you the whole story. Anyway, our people were getting kind of very nervous because we had lost 18 of our men, ages 16 to 61, and the Turkish soldiers brought more soldiers, and they were penetrating through the mountain, and they were getting really, really very desperate. Food was very scarce at that point. Little children were going around pulling on their mommy's skirts, I want food, I want milk, I want this, I want that. And they were getting real desperate. And at their last mass, Father Abraham gathered them all. They always had mass on Sundays. And they sang so, so anxiously, bitterly. And the Sharagan, we call the hymn, the liturgy, is called, Dear Lord, have mercy on us. In Armenian, that's called Dervo Ormia, which is a very, very good Sharagan, which is sung. And they started singing that very seriously. Dervo Ormia, Dervo Ormia, Dervo Ormia, Dervo Ormia. As they were still singing and crying, they stayed silent for a while. And all of a sudden, there was a jubilation. Everybody ran to the cliff. Thank you, God, you heard us. There was a big warship that stopped at the seashore. They had never seen that before. Before, they would sit in the dark fog, they would disappear. But this time, it really stopped. We had men who spoke French and English fluently. Very speedily, but very carefully, they went down the mountain. And everybody was still, you know, jumping, happy, yelling, calling, thank you, God. And at the same time, the gun shooting that was getting closer to them, and they even had bombs. They had made the Kebisev church a big center for their ammunition, the depot. So these two men go there, they speak to the captain, they explain to him that we are marooned on top of Musa Dagh. Please save us, the Turks are after us. Now, how did that ship notice that? They always had two men with two big boards and a sheet, and on top of that sheet, a red cross was embroidered by the young women. And around it, it says, we're Christians, save us. The Turks are killing us. And that's how they saw that. They were shaking that in front of the ship. What happens? The captain telegrams the superiors. They sent three more French ships and then one British ship. And at the same time, they bombed the depot that the Turks had, and everything went into flames. And the people were so happy that they're going to be saved. And on September 12th, four French ships and one British ship took all the Armenians from the top of that mountain. There were about 4,000, around 200. And they brought them to Port Said, Egypt. They had all the tents ready for them. And the British and the French provided the food, education for the kids, everything. And during that ship ride, the children were so happy running around with candy in their hands, and the people who didn't even have a shower, a bath, all these 53 days, they got happy to do that, and they got good meals, and they were very happy they were saved. My mom explained to me that older women, they said, we don't care where they're taking us now, as long as we're not under the Turkish bombs and the shooting, and we're out of here. So they stayed there 4 years while the war was going on. But at the same time, all the other towns that were deported in the Syrian desert, Deir Zor, they had no food. This is when the saying, when Americans would say to their, my girlfriend says, her grandmother used to say to her mother, eat your food. You know, there are a lot of starving Armenians that you ought to eat your food. So that phrase became very popular at that point because those Armenians had no food, no water. And after a while, if you don't have water and you keep walking in the desert, and Henry and I, my husband and I, went through the desert in an air-conditioned car, I could not tolerate it. Can you imagine those people having no horse or carriage to take them? They were bare feet in the very hot sand, walking. And the ones that were deported, by the way, were mostly women, babies, children, and elderly, because the young people were all being killed in the Turkish army. None of them returned. None of them returned. And thus, if the people were fainting, they just left them there, Jesus buried them alive. And this is known because there were, you know, people that came back and talked about that. It was very hard for my mom to talk about this, but I, being so interested in history, I always asked her questions. And I said to her, I said, what if a Turkish soldier came while you were bringing water, because the spring of the waters were far away from the main habitation on top of Musa Dagh? She said, I would have thrown myself out of the cliff. I said, you were. I felt so sad, and she started sobbing that she never thought she was going to see my father. And I started sobbing. I said, I'm glad you didn't jump off the cliff. You're here. You're my mom. And I hugged her. But the audacity of the Turkish government now denying this is just obnoxious. It's inhumane. And they are still denying it now. Our people are most disliked by the Turkish government because about 10 years ago, I did another program in another college about the genocide, and newspapers carried the story. And apparently, a Turkish person saw that, informed the Turkish embassy in New York, and the Turkish embassy had written a letter to the college that I did the lecture, saying that, who is this woman, Musa Dagh girl? There's no such place, she's lying. I didn't get angry. I said to the president, I said, why don't you write a letter to this person, invite them to come to the college, this is an educational institution, let's have a forum, let's have a debate, invite them, I'll be here ready for them. They wrote the letter. To this day, they have never gotten an answer. You know what that means. And the reason for that is because our people stood against them and we were saved. And how could they lie? Because all the other people that were deported, they died. If you go to the Syrian desert, there are pictures that people dig out, all the bones and the skulls of all Armenian people. So when people say April 24 on 1.5 million Armenians died, that's true, but I always like to add the other one that Sultan Hamid killed, about 300,000 to 400,000. That makes it almost 2 million. Now listen to this story. When Hitler was ready to attack Poland, he sent his military men, he says, go kill without mercy. This was, by the way, August 22nd, 1939. He said, go kill, no mercy. After all, who remembers the Armenian massacres? He was emboldened to do that. Now, I'm not sure, but many people think that if the Ottoman Empire, when they were doing those atrocities to the Armenians, if they were immediately punished severely, maybe the Holocaust may not have happened, because Hitler brazenly got up and said that. And not only the Jewish people lost 2 million, it was tripled. 6 million Jews were gone. And this is an atrocity that you have to eradicate from this world. And now as you're sitting here, as I'm talking, perhaps somebody's being beheaded or burned by ISIS. This is, all human beings are important. You know, Hitler wanted to create a master race. Thank God he did not succeed. And now the ISIS is trying to create a master religion. That is not acceptable to us. We live in America, and we have our Constitution. Our First Amendment gives us the right of our religion, speech, and press. And why do you think we have mosques in the United States? Because we have the freedom, and those Muslims come and enjoy their life. As a matter of fact, not long ago, my husband and I were talking to a Muslim, and Turkish Muslim. He is so happy to be out of that area because they're so unjust and so inhumane. He's so happy. His wife has a job. He's got a son and a daughter going to high school, and they're doing great, and he's planning for them to go to college. That's fine. That's fine. I think all the Muslims that are in America, they're happy, not the ones that over there, they kill each other. But the thing is this, that it's like a cancer. It's traveling from one place to the other. France has had 5 attacks already this year, within these 2 months, and it's spreading to other countries. Now, I hate to say this. I'm going to give you many commemorations that are good, but our country, our commander-in-chief, does not want to recognize the Armenian Genocide as genocide. That makes me very angry. Human beings are to be considered to tell the truth. And the very first time, in January of 2008, our commander-in-chief with his surrogate, Samantha Powers, they promised that if he's elected, he's definitely going to be commemorating the genocide. And his words were, it is our responsibility as a human rights nation, we'll do that. I ask you, what happened? Well, let me tell you what happens. The Turkish government sends millions of dollars, even though they're a democratic republic now, but they belong to a certain Muslim party. It's called AK Party. And they're very, very, very intense in their religion and in their Muslim Turkism that they want everybody to be. There are 312 members in their parliament who are that devout to that. And when there were commemorations of the Armenian Genocide in Istanbul, Erdogan, the president, Tayyip Erdogan, went over. He says, my condolences to you, and he disappeared. A couple days later, they had a big rally in the square with placards, professional placards, saying, Armenian Genocide never happened. And then they had even more obscene placards saying, Armenians are bastards. Excuse me? If they were, because they took their women, our women, and married them forcibly, maybe that's what they're talking about. Very sad. Even to this date now, as of 2007, I don't know if any one of you has heard about Hran Dink. He was a publisher. He was an educated person. He had his own office. He published a newspaper in Armenian and Turkish. And he was a very good peacemaker. He wanted to meet the Turkish leaders and the Armenian leaders to sit down and talk about this. Of course, as soon as he mentions the genocide, he was marked already. One morning, he's going to his office. In front of his office, he was shot with 3 bullets in the back of his head. And the young man who shot him, yelling out, "Oh, I shot the infidel! I shot the infidel!" as if he had a prize coming to him. 2011, you're going to see the pictures, by the way, in the exhibit room. I have Hunting's picture and a young soldier, Armenian soldier, who was in the Turkish army. After all, he's a Turkish citizen, so he joined the army. On the very day of the genocide, April 24, 2011, his friend, Turkish soldier, shot him. On that very day, on that very, very day, there was an old woman. She was in a taxi going to church, I guess. The driver knew that. Beat her up so badly and pushed her out. And there was another lady, 87 years old, with all her relics and all. She lived in an apartment. And her daughter came to visit her, a middle-aged woman. She found her mother in a pool of blood. She was stabbed 7 times. Her throat was slit. As if that was not enough, her blouse was opened with a sharp instrument. The perpetrators had made a cross right on her chest. And when she was crying and people came, human rights representative came and warned her. She said, "Please don't say anything. I just saw many plainclothes Turkish policemen. There'll be another genocide if anything is said. Please stay quiet." She forced herself not to say anything. The whole funeral was quiet. That's not all. There was a young man of 40. He taught in Istanbul Armenian school. His colleagues said, He's not here for 3 days. Let's call him and see what's going on. Maybe he's sick." They called, no answer. They finally said, "Let's go see how he's doing." They go, the door was ajar, and he was lying down, his throat slit, and he was in a pool of blood. They called the Turkish police. They came, and they said, "Oh, well, it must have been a robbery." That was it. Now, here's my big question. That's still going on. The human rights are being abused. Why are we an ally to Turkey? Their borders are wide open for the ISIS to go in and out. And this is no secret, because that woman who was with those groups in France, she immediately ran to Turkey. From there, she was in Syria, with no questions asked. And not long ago, last year, my husband is born in the mountainside of Syria a long time ago. In Kesab, there were 12 villages. The ISIS and all the other terrorists came, bombed the whole villages. Everybody ran out with just their clothes on. They left every belonging that they had in their homes and burned the churches and the schools. And I don't understand how we can be allies to people who are doing these things. It's just beyond me. I don't understand that. But I want to give my compliments, kudos to His Holiness Pope Francis, who gave a special mass for commemorating the Armenian Genocide with all the pontiffs of the Armenian Church. They even sang the Lord's Prayer in Armenian. And also, amazing things are happening in Europe. The Parliament of Europe, they have commemorated and made proclamations of the Armenian Genocide. Now, this is an interesting one. The Austrian-Hungarian group, which has six different parties in there, they all also have committed themselves to recognize the Armenian Genocide, and they were even forceful in saying this mass destruction must stop. And they were, during World War I, they were with the Turks. This was not with the Allies. This was with the Central Party group. And they are recognizing it too. And also, Rabbi Shmuley Potek, he wrote a beautiful article in the New York Times commemorating the Armenian Genocide. There are many, many more, which I give very big thank yous, especially our legislator too. And there are many states in the United States that honor this day. But I was hoping that our commander-in-chief would do the same. It just makes me very angry. It is not right to hate. As I said before, we're all children of God. It is not right to teach your young, innocent kids to hate. It isn't right to make your young people bind them with bombs to go on suicide bombings. It is not right to behead people. It is not right to put a person or persons in a cage and burn them. It is not right to have females mutilated. And I don't mean cutting a finger or a toe. It is not right. Hatred does not save anyone's life. Hatred is like a cancer. As our generals have been saying lately, we ought to have a very, very sound strategy to destroy ISIS. Because if not, we even have had samples of it in this country. Have you ever heard before anyone beheaded in this country? We had one already in Oklahoma. How about the two brothers in Boston? And how about Hassan at Fort Hood? He gets up, he says, Allahu Akbar, and shoots the military and other people injuring. Now, that was not a workplace violence. That was radical Islamic terrorism, period. We should eradicate that from all areas that we can. I'm just gonna pray that people understand humanness, to be human to each other, no matter what our ethnicity is, our skin color is, our religion is, or what countries. I'm sure all of you have backgrounds that you're ancestors came from some country, and they're all okay. We're all being creative in this country, which is our country. We're all Americans. You don't go around saying, I'm a Jewish American, I'm an Armenian American, I'm African American. We're all Americans, and we love our Constitution, and thank God for our founding fathers who so thoughtfully created our government, our Constitution, to protect everyone. But on the other hand, we ought not sit back and let people like the ISIS. By the way, those names change all the time. You know, originally the Hamas, Hezbollah, Al-Shabaab, Boko Haram, you name it, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, they're all Islamic terrorist groups. They ought to be eradicated. And I'm not using the word of the general, you have to be destroyed. That's the only way. Otherwise, we're going to be very, very sad people to be afraid for our lives all the time, and that isn't right. God Almighty is love. And those of you who believe that, fine. But I think that, as the good book says, love thy neighbor as thyself. It doesn't say love thy neighbor as yourself if they're the same religion as you are, or if they're the same color of face, or if they're the same ethnicity. It just says love thy neighbor as thyself. Who is your neighbor? Your neighbor is everyone that you see. The people who live across you, on the back of you, the people you work with, those are all your neighbors. Let's just say, let's acknowledge and honor our, I don't know what to call those, I would say victims, because they, some people call them martyrs. A martyr, as Dr. Richard Hovhaannissian said, that stuck in my head. I had gone to a conference at Drew University in 1997. He said, martyrs go willingly to die, but Armenians, about 2 million died. They didn't want to die. They were forced to die. So they were victims of the crime. So let's honor their memory and acknowledge it seriously. And the present, we're all living in the present. Let's celebrate our lives and empower our ability to be good to each other. That's the way to live. And the future, I think we ought to work very hard to ensure our future generations' livelihood and safety, because that's the way it should be. I thank you very, very much. I thank Kean University. And I'm going to say thank you in other languages. Those of you who understand it, that's for you. Thank you. That's in English. Armenian. Shnor Hagalem. Siba. That's in Russian. Xie xie. Chinese. Memnunim, Turkish, Jen Luke, Polish, Shukran, Arabic. Thank you all for your time. I love you all.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Oh, that is so lovely. Oh my God. And the ribbons are all in Armenian flag colors. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That's beautiful.
My name is Liz Turkey. I'm the director of the Human Rights Institute here at Kean. I just want to thank each of you for joining us tonight here, the Holocaust Resource Center and the Human Rights Institute, as we commemorate the centennial of the Armenian Genocide. The Human Rights Institute and the Holocaust Resource Center, we're committed to raising awareness about human rights, violations, atrocities, and genocide. And it's important to us that we remember the victims, that we commemorate the centennial anniversary of the Armenian Genocide. And we do so by ensuring that people today and for generations to come know and understand what has occurred. It's also important that we commemorate the Armenian Genocide by appreciation and celebration of Armenian culture, food, art, language, dance, and more. And tonight we did just that. So please join me in thanking our wonderful guests from the Shushi Armenian Dance Ensemble. And our wonderful author and human rights advocate, Ms. Virginia Apelian.
And the exhibit that you invited me to.
We invite all of you to enjoy the exhibit that is in the side adjoining room here to be a theater. And I hope that you found tonight's program inspirational and emotional remembrance of those who lost their lives 100 years ago. Please return to Kean University in the future. Visit the Human Rights Institute and Holocaust Resource Center. You are always welcome, and you're welcome to be part of the Kean community. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much. Love you. I had the honor to get a beautiful proclamation from the state of New Jersey legislator. At this point, I would like to call to my son, Christopher Apelian, Dr. Christopher Apelian, to come up and read that and then hand it over to Ms. Kropotsky.
New Jersey General Assembly, State House Trenton, New Jersey, Assembly Resolution by Assemblyman Weber. Whereas the year 2015 marks the 100th anniversary of what is considered to be the first mass genocide of the 20th century, when more than 1,800,000 Armenians were murdered or forced to flee their homeland in terror by the Ottoman Empire, an event which represents one of the most condemnable atrocities in the history of the world, and whereas the survival and recovery of the Armenian people from this terrible tribulation have given hope and inspiration to oppressed and persecuted peoples all over the world, and whereas on April 23rd, 2015, Kean University is sponsoring a special program to solemnly recognize and remember the victims of this devastating event in the hope that their memories can serve the conscience of the world, and it emphasizes the importance for all civilized nations to remain vigilant against tyranny to ensure that such atrocities will never again be committed. And whereas it is also fitting to pay tribute to the Armenian survivors, to offer thanks to them and their descendants for the many enriching contributions they have made to our culture and our way of life in this state and this nation, now therefore be it resolved by the General Assembly of the State of New Jersey, that this House hereby honors the memory of the Armenian martyrs on the 100th anniversary of their massacre and recognizes the survival of the Armenian and Armenian American people throughout the global community. And be it further resolved that a duly authenticated copy of this resolution be signed by the Speaker and attested by the Clerk.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Christopher. That was beautiful. And I think I have a letter that I had given to Janice from Congressman Frank Pallone, if you would be kind to read that.
And you can take this with you.
Thank you. This letter is dated April 23rd, 2015. Dear friends, it is with great pleasure that I write today to join you in marking the centennial of the Armenian Genocide. I would like to extend my appreciation to the Holocaust Resource Center and the Human Rights Institute at Kean University for hosting this commemoration. Today's observance marks a significant atrocity in history and is an opportunity to continue calls for recognition of the Armenian Genocide. I appreciate your efforts to honor the victims and survivors through the edification of Armenian culture and history. Together, we can continue to push this cause forward. As founder of the Congressional Caucus on Armenian Issues, I am an ardent supporter of Armenian issues and continue to make them one of my top priorities in Congress. This year, to mark the 100th commemoration of the genocide, I join my colleagues in sending a letter to President Obama, encouraging him to properly recognize this atrocity as genocide in his annual April 24th statement. Additionally, I have co-sponsored the Armenian Genocide Truth and Reconciliation Resolution, House Resolution Number 154, which calls for reconciliation between Armenia and Turkey based on an acceptance of the historic facts of the genocide. I have been fortunate to work with the Armenian community on various issues and look forward to continuing to do so. Once again, thank you for hosting today's commemoration and your ongoing work in bringing awareness to human rights violations in the hopes of creating change. Sincerely, Frank Pallone, Jr., Member of Congress.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. հացիկ մահվան մրայր հանդեսին, երբ գերար գյանքը ձեր շուրջ, ձեր հոգիները հավատքով ու հույսով, հույսով արելություն, ձեր հոգիները հանցնեցիք խավարին, հանցնեցիք խավարին, խավարին. Եթե ոսկե թարոված միջը մեր, շուշանիգի հոգիով հմայված եղիշեն, տեսավ հայգին իր շխաչյա բադերեն, հաստատ հավատքով, բողբատյա գամքով, հետ ու համբերով, ժողովրդին հավերժության համար, երկինք պարձրացող իր հուր մատներով, Արցախեն ու խոս ծարերեն եկող, ծավեր թարմանով, քույրերը մեր նորը։
Thank you. Amen, Sazi, Metal Kovats, Kundamanta, Siskamanja, Nakas Marti, Shigana, Pesni, Kunara, Siskamanja, Nakas Marti, Shigana, Pesni, Kunara,
Thank you. Aşkın adamı